And I don't think I need to point any of this out to you. It's been discussed already this afternoon and ad nauseum prior to today, that the research staff tend to have a very high turnover rate, especially those that are on short-term contracts. One of the problems that research staff associations face as a result is a loss of knowledge. So when you, for instance, when you put together a research staff association at your local university or institute and work very hard at putting together programs to benefit your fellow researchers, eventually you're going to move on 2 or 3 years down the line to another career or another lab. And a lot of that knowledge is going to go if you don't find a way to leave something behind. So one of the most important things that you can do is to structure your research staff association in such a way that everyone is not left sort of in the dark after you leave. And what we've done at Dundee is create a committee that oversees the activities of the Research Staff Association. Again, I'm speaking only from my own experience. And one thing that I've insisted upon doing since becoming chair is making very clear what the roles and responsibilities of individuals on the committee are, so that when people come onto the committee, they know exactly what they're in for. It's one way to recruit people as well, because very often as a researcher, you're so busy and you're so focused, and we're all doing this as volunteers. You don't want to be bothered by something that's vague. You're not going to participate if you don't know exactly what to expect when you get involved. Also very important is effective communication. You know, you're representing research staff, and you, for your own benefit, as well as for the benefit of all the research staff, you need to communicate very effectively. So this is both with researchers and also with the administration that you're working alongside. And as an aside, this is a bit of a segue, but I wanted to propose for those of you who are involved with research staff associations, it would be really helpful, I think, for other communities of researchers that want to put together some sort of forum for the benefit of researchers that they're working with. It would be very helpful if you would put together some history of how your research staff association formed, some detailed descriptions of what you do. For instance, do you put on a seminar series or something along those lines? And then examples of what you've done. So this is something that we're starting to do in Dundee now. And I think it would be very helpful in nurturing nascent research staff associations, because when you're first starting off, you don't really know what to do. And there are a couple other things that you can do. For instance, Sarah had mentioned finding someone like herself who's very, very active, proactive in getting things up. Find an ally, and that really is essential. But also having a sense of what's been done before, what's come before, is really, I think, going to be very useful. And we're trying to do this actually on a regional level in Scotland at the moment. I won't go into any detail about how we structure the postdoc association in Dundee. I simply want to point out that we have one individual, with regards to preserving knowledge, we have one individual who is assigned to represent our committee with different boards throughout the college. So for instance, the College of Life Sciences has a board. Within that, the School of Research has a separate board meeting. The Health and Safety Committee, the Concordat Steering Group, which is a university-wide group. And someone attends each of those meetings. And so what they do then is not only do they participate in matters that are related to that board's remit, but also they will tell the board what's going on with the research staff at the university. And as a result, the administration becomes a resource, it becomes a reservoir of knowledge, so that when eventually researchers do move on, the administration knows what's been going on. Additionally, faculty, we have two faculty advisors that sit on our committee, and they meet with us monthly. They know everything that's going on, and they oftentimes will give input and advice. We find this very useful for obvious reasons, but also they then also serve as a reservoir of knowledge. That way, if something happens and someone moves on, you can make sure, you know, the faculty advisors know what's going on in the research staff community. And finally, partners. I pointed out before generic skills and revealing research, the training and outreach organizations in Dundee and BioDundee as well. These guys will also know what's going on. They are also a reservoir of knowledge. And then, of course, Vitae on a national level can serve as a resource. So what other ways can we ensure that the high turnover in research staff and over short time periods does not unduly influence research staff associations? How can we ensure that we maintain momentum? And what other resources are of value to research staff? Can these resources be used for career development? So, and by that, I mean things like, for instance, the Concordat. The Concordat sort of lays out exactly what we need to keep in mind as researchers. And that's what I want to end with. I want to end with two issues that influence researchers. And I want to put them in terms of the Concordat. So the first is that research staff are very hard to engage. And I'm saying this to you, and you're all here, so it's not necessarily fitting to berate you or anything, but the research staff that I work with generally are very focused on their own work, and so they don't necessarily want to be bothered with an association. And how can you engage them? A few things. The first thing to keep in mind is that, according to the Concordat, it's essential that researchers take responsibility for their own career development. And I don't think that you need the Concordat to tell you that. But how can we ensure that researchers are being engaged in their own career development? One way is to structure research associations in a simple fashion. As I said, lay things out in such a way that there is no learning curve, that people can participate very quickly, they know what they're in for. Ensure associations are representing the interests of researchers. For example, don't put on a seminar series if no one's coming to the seminars. If, for instance, you have a group of researchers who are having trouble with statistics for whatever their field is, then maybe it's time to talk to your local training coordinator about putting on a statistics course. So make sure that you're serving the needs of the research staff that you represent. You want to facilitate interactions among researchers. This can be anything. This can be pub quizzes or any sort of social events. It can be a Cayley, what have you. And this, in part, gets people to know each other, because if you work in a very big institute or you're geographically sort of diffuse, then you don't necessarily meet a lot of people who are in a similar position, who are researchers who are working hard. They're focusing most of their time on their research. It gives them a chance to get out. And it also, by engaging researchers in general, you engage them specifically in their career development. And finally, it seems like it should go without saying, but you really do need to sell the benefits of career development. You really do need to convince people that this is important for them individually and in general on a large scale. And I think this is something that VTI goes a long way towards helping, because this is a resource that's available to everyone, and everyone can go and seek it on their own time. In addition to engaging researchers and research staff, you also, I believe, need to engage research managers. And so in the same principle in the Concordat, it says research managers have a responsibility to the researchers that work for them to mentor and also to provide tools for their career development. So there's a potential conflict or perceived conflict between researchers and research managers, namely that research managers don't really have any impetus. There's no reason for them to promote our career development necessarily. And that's not entirely true, but that's how a lot of research managers are perceived to think, whether they do or not. And one way to get around this is to put together a few systematic tools. For instance, implementing routine monitoring and evaluation. This is effectively appraisals. Make sure that you're meeting on a regular basis with your supervisor, with the person that you answer to talk about your career, to talk about your progress, both working in that particular setting, in that research setting, and also what you want to do in the future and how they can help you. So a little bit of back and forth. The worst thing that you can do, regardless of how eminent your research manager might be, you want to make sure that you're communicating with them, because it's really not helpful for your career if you see them once a year, for instance. And in some cases, if they're very eminent and they're very busy, that may be the case. But if at all possible, it's best to avoid that and find an appraisal system where you can meet with them and talk about what you need and what you're doing for them and how you're progressing. You also want to create a mentoring system to support researchers. As a mentor, you don't necessarily need to have someone who's going to be your research advisor, your research manager. It can be someone in a completely different field, but you need to have someone who can help you to think about your career, and especially someone who's outside of your own career development and can give you that perspective. And finally, leadership and management training at all levels. I think it goes without saying, if you wanted to be a research manager at some point, and if research is what you do, then you would benefit from having leadership and management training, so that when you get into the position that your advisor currently is now, you can help them. You can help their career development and ensure that they do the best for you as well. And I probably don't need to tell you that there are quite a number of, and maybe you've had this experience, quite a number of research managers currently that would also benefit from having a little bit of leadership and management training. So whether that, how that gets implemented, I don't know. I will leave that to people who are much higher up the ladder than me. So what other strategic and practical issues face researchers? Yep. And this doesn't necessarily be with regards to career development. It can be in general. But I'm curious to hear what you think, what other things are on your mind. And some of the issues have been brought up today. And in particular, can these issues be addressed through VTI and the implementation of the Concordat? What role do you think there is for research staff associations at various levels? And is there anything else that's necessary? So I'd like to hear what you think. And this is a view of Dundee from my flat, and you're all welcome to come visit anytime.